So next we come to the definition of inverse function. How we define inverse of a function? So inverse of a function can only be defined when function is 1, 1 and onto. If a function which is 1, 1 and onto, we call the function is bijective. If function is bijective, then we can define its inverse. So its inverse is defined by if f is defined from a to b, it is 1, 1 and it is onto, then I can define inverse of the f, which is because we are defining inverse, then this domain and codomain will be changed. So f of inverse will be b from b to a. So f inverse y will be x if and only if f of x equal to y, because f is 1, 1 and onto map, then we can define. Because what is the condition for defining in g of f composition of a function? Condition was that the codomain of one function should be the domain of other function. So if I try to find the composition of f inverse over f into x, because f of x comes to b, so b is the domain for f inverse, so it is good. I'll get f inverse of element from the b. It is identity in the set A. Now I am defining f of f inverse y. So f inverse y, when I find f inverse y, because y belongs to b, so f inverse y will be an element in set A. So f of a, I defined f over the set A. So f of f inverse y is definable. I can define it, and it is equal to the identity of set B. So now we come to the next example, which is I defined f from real number to real number. A function is a cube function, and we can easily define this function. Like I'm taking a subset of real number, say set of natural numbers. So f of 1 will be 1, f of 2 will be 8, and f of 3 will be 27. In the similar way, I can easily show that this function is 1, 1. For each for distinct element, I'll get distinct cubes. So cube of if it will be a square function, then I cannot say this is a 1, 1 function. Why? Because square of 1 and minus 1 is always 1. So it is not a 1, 1 in the case of a square function. But in the case of cube function, it is a 1, 1 function. Why? Because cube of negative and positive are different. So this is a 1, 1 function. I take any number, any two distinct number, I'll get distinct cubes of those numbers. So this is a 1, 1 function, and on the same way I can define it is a onto function, because I can take any function from the codomain R and I can find its preimage, which is cube root of that number, will again be in the R. So the inverse function for this cubic function will be cube root of x. So it is defined by this. F inverse is cube root of x. Or think of the graph of the function, cubic function. It is like a curve from passes through the origin O and negative to positive. So they like how we in a graph, how we show a function is 1, 1 and onto, we just draw a straight line. If it cuts the graph only at one point, then the function is 1, 1. Like if we take a graph of a square function, it is kind of parabola, which is open on the y-axis, towards the y-axis. So if I draw a line parallel to the x-axis, it cuts the parabola at two ends. So in this case, this function is not 1, 1. But if I draw a graph of x cube, it is kind of S. And I draw a line parallel to x-axis, it cuts the graph only at one point. So function is 1, 1 as well as onto. So it is a bijection. So I can find inverse of the function. When a function is bijective, we can find the inverse. So inverse function of cube function is cube root function. So next we come to the binary operation. What is a binary operation? Binary operation is a function from x cross x to x. This is x cross s means we are taking elements in tuples, two tuples, like first element will be from this first x, and second element from will be from the second x. So if I am saying r cross r means I am taking 1 comma 2, 2 tuple. So how do we define binary operation? Binary operation, basically, we study in the fundamental mathematics, there are two type of binary operation at the basic level, addition and multiplication. So I define in example 6, addition from A, n cross n to n, and multiplication by m, n cross n to n, are binary operation where, how do we find the value of A, x, y, because this is two tuple, n cross n, so A of x, y will be x plus y, because A is the addition function. What A will do? A will just add these two numbers. And what M will do? M will multiply these two numbers. So I think it is clear to everybody. So next topic is about, study about the function. Now we come to the countability. What is countability? So when we talk about the set, we generally talk about how many elements are there in a set. So if, say, number of elements in a set are finite, say there is a set 1 to 10. A is a set where elements are from 1, 2, 3 up to 10. So there are total elements 10. So we say this set is finite, A is finite, and number of elements in the set are 10. So 10 is called the cardinality of set A. So trying to do, suppose I have taken a function f from L to R, L is the set of left shoe in a wardrobe, and R is the set of right shoe, and I'm trying to match the left shoe with the right shoe. If there is no right shoe left in the wardrobe, then I'll say ki both the pair of left, all the left shoes are equal to the right shoe. So there is no right shoe left. So in this way, we say L and is numerically equivalent to R. Set L is numerically equivalent to R. If I get to know, I just told you there were a set A where 10 elements, then I'll say 10 is the cardinality of the set. If set is finite, I can find the cardinality. Simply, cardinality of a set will be a natural number because I can count the element. For counting anything, we use natural number. And if set is infinite, then we talk about countably infinite, or if it is countably infinite, then also we call it a countable set. If it is not countably infinite, then we'll say it uncountable set. So we'll come to these things later. So now we have definition 6, which defined two sets A and B have equal cardinality, means they are numerically equivalent. Is written by this symbol, similarity symbol, if there is a bijection between A and B. Bijection means I can define a map which is 1, 1 and on 2. If the two sets are there and I can define a map between these two sets and which is 1, 1 and on 2, I will say these two sets are equal, have the same number of elements or numerically equivalent. If I define a map from set A to B and this map is 1, 1, but not onto, then I'll say number of elements in set A are less than or equal to the number of elements in set B. Because what is the definition of function? Definition of function is that every element in the set A maps to some element in set B. If set B has this thing with it, there can be a few elements which are left, which can be left in set B. But in the set A, no element can be left. As I told you, each student should occupy a chair. So in this case, but chair can be left. Suppose if a student have adjusted on a chair and then a few chairs are left. So set B has this thing, ki some things are left. Can be left. So in this case, if I define a 1-1 map from A to B, then B has more element than A because I defined a 1-1 map. What is a 1-1 map? 1-1 map is that distinct element of set A maps to the distinct element of set B. If 1-1 map is defined, definitely B has more than more element than more or equal element than set A. So in this case, we can define A is less or equal to B if there is one one map, not necessarily onto. If it is onto, then we'll say they are numerically equivalent. Generally, what we do to find the cardinality of a set, whether it is countable or not countable, we generally take help from the set of natural number. We define a map from that set to the set of natural number. So if I want to know whether I have a set this A, whether this set is countable or not, I just define a map F from set A to set of natural number. If it is 1, 1, then I'll say, yes, it is countable. If it is 1, 1 and onto both, then I'll say they are equivalent. The set A is equivalent to set of natural number. So now we come to the definition of this finite. What is a finite set? Finite set, either the set is empty, phi, there is no element, then I'll say it is finite. If there are a few elements, then I can number those elements with this set 1 to n. So A is equivalent to this set 1 to n. N is some natural number. Say A is, I just told you 1 to 10. So if n is 10, then A is countable and its cardinality is 10. If n is 20, then I'll say A is countable and its cardinality is 20. If there is 1, 1 map from A to n, and onto map from N to A. If it is onto, like we have seen, there was the last example in the function. There were three elements in the set input, and there was one element, four, in the output. That function was onto. So in this case, if I define an onto map, then I'll say A has less element than N, then again, it is a countable. I hope you are able to get the definition of countable. So next thing, the point two is countably infinite or denumerable. What is countably infinite? If A is numerically equivalent to N, that is, if I can define a bijection between A and N. Bijection means 1, 1 and onto map. So we'll say set A is countably infinite or countable. Countable if it is finite or countably infinite. We say set A is countable if it is either it is finite or it is countably infinite. If it is not countable, then we'll say set is uncountable. So we take few things obvious, like subset of a finite set is finite and subset of a countable set is countable. And we can also distinguish between finite set, countable set, countably infinite set, and uncountable set. So basically, what we need to do, we just need to define a map between the set and the set of natural number. Next, we come to the example 7. This is very beautiful example because we have not seen such type of example in the set of finite. Like I have a set, finite set, which has element 1 to 15, and I define another subset of this set A, say B, and which has element 1 to 10. So basically this set B has less element than A. So I cannot say ki A is numerically equivalent to set B in the case of finite. But in the case of infinite, I can tell this. This is very beautiful function. Again, it is a square function. So you see, I can define a bijection between a bijection F from N to S. Bijection means 1, 1 and onto map. For each element in N, like N is infinite set and S is also infinite set. So for every element, say 1, I'll map 1 to its square, 2 to its square and 3 to its square. So in this way, I can show the function is 1, 1 because distinct elements are mapped to their square. Squares are also distinct. If elements are distinct, then their square will also be distinct. I am taking here a set of natural number, not a set of integer or real number. Because if I take set of integer or real number, then there will be a clash between them. Because they all are positive. So for positive numbers, square will be different. I'll take two distinct elements and then their square will also be distinct. So clearly this map is 1. Now I talk about onto map. So what is onto map? For each y in S, there must exist x and n such that f of x equal to y. In S, there are square. For one, I can find a premise which is one. For two, I can for four, I can find a premise which is two. I just take a square root of these number in S. So every element have premise. So this is one one and onto. So we can clearly see S is S has less element than n because S does not contain 3, 5, 7. So S has less element than n, but they are numerically equivalent. So this is the beauty of countably infinite set. We come to the next thing, which is proposition. Every subset of natural number is countable. And next one is, like as I told you earlier in the previous example, if n is countable, then its every subset will be countable. A non-empty set A is countable if and only if there is an onto map from N to A. So onto map means ki A has less element than N. Then I'll say A is countable. If I define a map from A to N and I show the map is 1, 1, then A has less element than N. Then again, I'll say A is countable. If I can define map F from N to A and I show this map is onto, then it will be again, A will be a countable set. And this is also a Cartesian product of n cross n is countably infinite, means again countable. Or a countable union of countable sets is countable. Say I have taken 10 countable sets and I have taken the union of those 10 sets. Then the union will be countable, means countable union of countable sets is countable. Union should be countable. Like you can take union till the finite times only. So you cannot take union of the infinite sets. You are taking union for a countable union. So it will again a countable set. So to prove these proposition, we need to know basic things about natural numbers, which are called Peano axioms. Peano axioms contains two things. First is well ordering principle and second is principle of mathematical induction. These are very basic things. One should know these things. So what is well ordering principle? If I take any non-empty subset of natural number, it has least element. Say I have taken a set 1 to 10. So what is, I have taken a subset of natural number, say a set of even numbers. So if I take set of even number, in this 2 will be the least element. And if I remove 2 from this set, then 4 will be the least element. If I remove 2 and 4 both, then 6 will be the least element. So we cannot say that 2, 4, 6 will be the least element. Least element will be unique in the set. Least means smallest element. So similarly for the odd number, least element will be 1. If I remove 1 from the set of odd number, then least element will be 3. This is the well ordering principle. Now we come to the principle of mathematical induction. So let S is the subset of N, which satisfies these two things. First thing is 1 belongs to S. And second thing is if M belongs to S, implies M plus 1 will belongs to S. If these two conditions satisfy, then I'll say S is nothing but the set of natural number. S is equivalent to set of natural number. How it is true? Say 1 belongs to S and these two conditions satisfied. If 1 belongs to M, so any M in natural number belongs to S, implies M plus 1 also belongs to S. If 1 belongs to S, then 1 plus 1 again belongs to S, 2 belongs to S. If 2 belongs to S, then 2 plus 1 again belongs to S, so 3 belongs to S. If 3 belongs to S, 3 plus 1 again belongs to S, so 4 belongs to S. So S is nothing but the set of natural numbers. So I hope it is clear to all. So we are going to prove first proposition and rest can be proved. I have given references in the end of this presentation. You can go through those texts and find the proof of the other. And first is very simple proof. Suppose what we are going to prove, every subset of natural number is countable. We are going to use these two things, Peano axioms, well ordering principle or principle of mathematical induction. and this is if A is subset of N. First condition, if A is empty, then there is nothing to prove. What we are going to prove? A, every subset of natural number is countable. So I think this statement is clear. If A is empty, then there is nothing to prove. And the second statement is that if A is non-empty, then by well ordering principle, A has the least element. So suppose that least element is A1. So now what I'm going to do, I take another set, I remove that least element A1, and the new set will be capital A1, which is A minus A1. So this new set, capital A1, is either empty or non-empty. If it is empty, then we have nothing to prove because there was only one element A1 in set A. So countable. If it is non-empty, then what would we do? We say A, again, the by the well ordering principle, A1 has the least element, say A2. Least element, then I again define a set A2. What is A2? A2 is A1 minus A2. So I remove A2. The same thing will I do. Either it is empty or non-empty. If it is empty, then there is nothing to prove because there were only two elements, A1, A2 in A. So it is countable. I keep repeating this process. What I'll get, either this process will terminate or I will have a bijection between N and these elements, A1, A2, A3, dot, dot. So how I'll have bijection between these two things, two sets. One set is set of natural number, other set is A1, A2, A3, and so on. So what I'll do, I just I define a function f from N to this set. And how I define a function? I define the function like first element go to the first subscript, which has subscript as 1. And second element go to A2, and third to A3. In this way, I'll define a function. And I'll clearly show a bijection between them. So the set will be numerically equivalent to set of natural number, so countable. I hope it is clear to all.